Hello and welcome to HID All Access, a podcast focusing on physical access control systems. What are the trends, what are the drivers, and what are the benefits? Today we are discussing which verticals are adopting mobile access systems and how they are benefiting. Also, is the younger generation influencing how mobile credentials are being rolled out in higher education? We also look at ESG factors like carbon footprint or plastic cards versus mobile solutions. My expert advisors are Sanjit Bardhan, Phil Coppola, and Jason Schimpf. So Sanjit, as a starting point in 23, which verticals and industries do you see predominantly moving from plastic to mobile? Can you share any insights on that?
Thanks, Roy. One of the biggest challenges that we see that customers are resolving very quickly pertain to verticals such as commercial real estate. Hospitality is massive because you see a lot of guests wanting mobile passes on their devices. We see a lot of banking and finance customers, as well as enterprise, large enterprise organizations that have to deal with challenges of managing plastic credentials, inventorying them, issuing them, and managing them. And of course, mobile credentials may take all these pains away, and there are obviously lots of benefits associated with that. So if you were to ask me, give me the top four, these would be the top four, but we see very loosely a lot of other enterprise organizations, small, medium businesses, adopting to this technology very quickly.
Yeah, absolutely. I think the other vertical that that's really taken off is higher education, right? One of the benefits of going to a school is sort of the student experience, right? And so as a student, I want to go to a university that's sort of up on the most current technology. And obviously moving the student ID to a wallet or to an app-based credential really sort of sets that university apart from its competitors in that realm. And then to your point, we see enterprises adopting mobile credentials because students that are coming out of university have come to expect that experience.
A recent study that we conducted, we found out that a lot of the demand is being generated by the new gen of users, the Gen Zs, and in the future, Gen Alphas. They are used to apps on devices. They are used to every single thing, part of their daily activity being driven by apps, and they demand that. We've seen that a lot of Gen Zs and millennials are actually making career decisions based on companies that actually offer green initiatives, mobile devices, eco-friendly alternatives.
The other one Sanjit mentioned before is the commercial real estate, specifically on the wallet. You're getting these buildings that are being built and they're trying to attract the high-tech businesses that are growing, that people are investing in to come in. And if they've got to carry all these different plastic cards around, it just goes directly against these tech companies. An industry that I think is actually going to take off very soon in the wallet credential space is going to be any industry that's going to be regulation and compliance heavy. So like finance, for example, because when you're looking at how easy it is to provision and deprovision the credentials, and you think about you have to go and show a history and an audit report to these compliance and regulation entities showing all the approval process and when people were no longer having access to it, the wallet experience just makes that so easy and the auditing experience so much easier. And that industry, I think, is just going to take off in a really in the very near future.
Troy, you've spent a lot of time in the commercial real estate space. So what do you think about this industry and why is that adopting so quickly?
I think it's because the movement of people. If you look at different industries around the world, commercial real estate, you know, there's a box, there's people coming in and out of it every single day in mass numbers as opposed to, you know, smaller sort of segments. They have a key need to get people in and out of the building in the most effective way. Also, instead of physically issuing them cards or posting them out or anything like that, issuing them on the fly so they come into the building on Monday morning, they go up to their tenancy or their suite, it's a seamless journey. So it makes sense for commercial real estate because it's fixing a real-world problem.
Yeah, what I think what a lot of people don't realize about mobile credentials in particular, whether it's an app-based or wallet-based credential, is that ease of provisioning process, right? Mm-hmm. If I'm a new employee in a commercial building, you know, I live close to New York City, you could have a building that's got 10, 15, 20,000 people in it. You have a constant flow of new individuals coming in and out every day. Having to provision a pass for the base building and then a pass for the tenant space, and what about the amenity spaces, where a mobile credential can just be provisioned either via email or through a self-service provisioning process through an app. Right, I go into my app, I request my pass, it lands in my wallet, and I go through the door. And by the way, that allows me through the door, it allows me through the turnstile, it gets me up the elevator and into my tenant space, all without ever actually having to request a card from an individual or from an office.
And that resonates very well with the new breed of employees that come in into the modern workspace today.
We're seeing the Gen Z and millennial generation that, as excited as they are to get in the workforce, they've grown up with a phone in their hand. And so it's all about that user experience for them. And I know Gen Z and millennials that don't even carry a physical, what we would call a traditional billfold or wallet around, where you would typically keep an ID badge and hanging something off of your lanyard or something. While some companies have that regulation or rule, we're seeing that go away. But these kids don't understand that today.
And I think two things there. One, the tech giants, the Apples, the Googles, the Samsungs of the world, they've trained an entire generation of people, myself included, and I think our parents included in that, in how to use the wallet already, right? So you see folks of various age groups going to the grocery store, tapping their phone, and paying for their groceries. The same is true for all sorts of different applications out there where everything is done from the phone. I think the other thing that's driving the adoption and demand for mobile, again, from the user generation perspective, is the argument around sustainability. As organizations come up with their ESG mandates, with their corporate social responsibility goals, to be good corporate citizens, they recognize that they need to do something good for the environment. Well, printing a bunch of plastic badges is probably not the best thing to do from a sustainability perspective, whereas a mobile credential obviously has a very limited carbon footprint as opposed to the plastic process.
So, Phil, let me double-click on this whole carbon footprint thing that you spoke about. So you've got a series of videos that you release on the on social media, on YouTube, LinkedIn, etc. Why don't you talk a little bit about the carbon footprint that plastic generates versus mobile?
So when we look at the production of PVC plastic, PVC requires a ton of energy in order to produce one metric ton. So the research is that that can range between 35 and 60 gigajoules of energy per metric ton of PVC plastic. And even if we take the low end of the estimate, 35 gigajoules, what does that equate to? It equates to a 10,000 kilowatt hours of energy, which is the same amount of energy that the standard U.S. household uses in a year. Wow. Just to produce one ton. And again, people might say, well, I don't use a ton of plastic, but how long have you been using cards? How many boxes of 1,000 cards have you ordered over the course of time? You'd be surprised that, you know, a card is not, you know, weightless. It does have some weight to it, and over the course of time, those numbers add up. And then when you factor in, going back to our earlier conversation about the provisioning process, if you're dedicating space to the provisioning of plastic cards, well, that also has a carbon footprint associated with it, right? Mm-hmm. So the larger that office, the more carbon you're putting off into the atmosphere. I think the EIA in the United States estimates that per square foot of office space, you burn about 15 kilowatt hours. Over the course of time, those carbon numbers really start to add up. I think the estimate is for folks that are using 100,000 cards or more, you're looking at the same amount of energy to fly around the Earth three times at the equator. I mean, it's a serious amount of energy that gets dumped into not just the distribution, but the production of the cards. And when I talk about distribution, too, part of the newsletter that I put out didn't include the transportation costs, the carbon transportation costs associated with getting that PVC plastic into the production process for a company like HID to put the metal bits and bobs in there to make the card work, and then shipping it to a distributor, and then that distributor shipping it to your office, and then from the channel partner's office to the end user space. So the numbers that I used in that newsletter are actually quite conservative in that regard.
Right, yeah, right.
Thanks to our expert advisors, Sanjit Bardhan, Phil Coppola, and Jason Schimpf. If you'd like to get one of our experts to advise you on your physical access control system, please visit hidglobal.com. We'd be happy to give you a no-obligations consultation to help you on the road to modernizing your access control. I'm Troy Johnston, and this has been the HID All Access podcast.